Well, good afternoon and welcome. My name is Marc Nemenoff, and we are here today to have a brief conversation on the use of leverage in the futures market. First, let me tell you a little bit about myself. I'm a 37-year veteran of the futures industry. While attending graduate school at the Illinois Institute of Technology, I took a job as a clerk on the trading floor of the Chicago Mercantile Exchange for the Tabor Grain Company. I quickly found that my background in both math and problem-solving techniques were adaptable to the futures market as well as the career I had been pursuing in architecture and urban planning. Having decided on a career change, I quickly rose within the Tabor Grain Company organization, became their analyst and operations manager for all products traded on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange. In 1976, my responsibilities increased when I was granted full membership on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange as Tabor Grain Company's representatives to that exchange. I was their head analyst and liaison to all branch offices. In addition, I was in charge of designing hedging strategies in both the livestock and financial sectors of the market and writing the firm's daily and weekly market letters. In 1980, I purchased my own membership on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange and spent the next 12 years as an independent trader, trading in all markets with a concentration in live cattle as a spreader and a market maker. As a member of the exchange, I served on many committees, including live cattle, nominating, contributions, public relations and advertising, and orientation and education. During this time, I gave speeches to various groups at the behest of the exchange. These included agricultural bankers, the National Cattlemen's Association, various groups on the role of the market maker, and various groups on the role of futures as a risk management tool. In 1991, I left the floor and spent my time as an independent trader and lecturer, giving speeches at seminars on various topics. These included livestock trading, interest rate futures, spreads, technical analysis, and trading in the pit versus being an outside speculator. I also taught classes as a guest lecturer at the Chicago Mercantile Exchange on spreading, technical analysis, and commodity options. Since 2004, I've been an associated person, or as you would probably call it, a broker, handling customer accounts for both speculators and hedgers. I am also author of the Nemenoff Report, a daily overview of the markets, adding my own perspective on market direction. Well, that's enough about me. Let's get to the heart of the matter. What is leverage? As defined by the Oxford Dictionary, the power to accomplish a purpose. Let's further define it as using outside capital to enable an entity to buy or sell a quantity of goods with the purpose of making a profit. This can be anything from live cattle, soybeans, to treasury instruments and stock index futures. By having a futures account, you're entering into a highly leveraged trading investment vehicle. What I want to discuss is making you aware of how much leverage you are using and the amount of leverage available to you. As I'm sure all of you know, margin funds are required every time you initiate a position. The example I'm going to use is the widely traded mini S&P contract. Initial margin required to hold a position overnight is currently about $6,500. For argument's sake, let's say the S&Ps are trading at $1,250. Putting the contract value at $62,500, or $1,250 times $50. All you have in your account is $6,500. The leverage you are using is 9.615 to 1. This is also the initial leverage that the exchange is allowing you to have, as represented by the contract value divided by the initial margin required at the current contract value, meaning roughly today's value. Sounds easy enough if you look at the illustration. Let's make it more complicated. Day trade margins, to the best of my knowledge, are set by the individual firms and vary widely from firm to firm. Let's say your firm will let you trade with an intraday margin of $1,000 per contract. This puts your leverage at 62.5 to 1. As you can see, that the value of the contract, 62,500 divided by 1,000. Let's take a look at this next graphic, and the example shows what the average leverage is depending on how much money you have in your account and how much you in your own mind are using as margin. You can see how steep the curve drops. The more money that you're using for margin, the less leverage you have. Now that you have the basics, let's again get more complicated. If you're using day trade margins of $1,000 per contract and trading with the maximum leverage of 62.5 to 1, by initiating a trade with the maximum amount of contracts afforded by your equity, let's say if you have $10,000, there'd be 10 contracts, it's time to look at market activity. Again, for argument's sake, let's say the average daily range in the S&P is 10 full points, or $500 per contract. If you use a 4-point stop, or $200 a contract, you are essentially risking 20% of your equity at a leverage of 62.5 to 1. Now, just because you're allowed this much leverage doesn't mean that you should use it. Remember Bear Stearns? They went under when their leverage grew to 50 to 1, making even small negative market movements just about disastrous. Anyone out there remember the bailout of long-term capital a few years back? They were leveraged in some instances in their portfolio at 200 to 1, and these were supposed to be the best and brightest analysts in the business. Now, I'm not here to tell you how much of your equity to commit on a daily basis or a per-trade basis, only to make you aware of the advantages and pitfalls of using the leverage available to you. Now, let's look at initiating a trade without a time constraint, meaning you are willing to hold a contract or contracts for more than one day. Your leverage is going to be greatly reduced, allowing you the ability to withstand some degree of adverse market movement. Doing a cursory look at things, the average daily range for the S&Ps being close to 1%, and the average daily change 0.5%, plus or minus a little, we're looking at an average daily change on a more than $60,000 item of only $300. This is only one example. Other markets offer much greater leverage, such as currencies and bonds. Just think. In the euro currency, $1,000 can control 125,000 euros, or about $160,000 worth of euros for one day, giving you a leverage of 160 to 1. Overnight margin of about 6,000 still gives you more than 25 to 1 leverage. The bonds, pretty much the same thing. The grains, about 35 to 1 for day trades, and about 12 to 1 overnight. Metals, well, let's do the math. Current overnight margin in silver is about $9,000, and that will get you $150,000 worth of silver. Once you have the basic tools, it's not difficult to figure out. Remember, using leverage is an efficient use of capital. The amount of leverage you use is up to you. Bottom line, the less leverage you use, the less risk, and the better you'll be able to stay in the market if you have a long-term perspective. The more leverage you use, the more immediate your market participation has to pay off. It's a fine line to walk to find the happy medium of what best suits your individual risk tolerance. Let me put it another way. After trading for more than 30 years and having more than my share of trades, which have been hazardous to my wealth, I've learned to deal in worst-case scenarios. In other words, how much can I afford the risk on a trade if I am wrong and something disastrous takes place? I'll give you a few examples. The announcement of mad cow disease drove cattle prices limit down for days, not allowing you to get out of the market very easily. flash crash in the stock market last year, and crop reports late last year, being 2010, which put corn and soybeans limit up among other scenarios in the recent past.